Thank you. Thanks for the kind introduction. So today's lecture was going to be about cobordisms and cobordism categories. I hope it will be quite elementary. So let's start from the definitions. I think cobordisms have been mentioned earlier in this summer school, but let me just tell you what I mean. So it's the usual picture. There's an incoming and an outgoing boundary, and then the cobordism itself. So just to emphasize what's part of the data, a cobordism from M0 to M1. So these are should be closed D minus one manifolds, smooth. Closed in these lectures means compact and no boundary, not necessarily connected. Cobordism is a smooth manifold. Smooth, compact D manifold. And then the boundary should be identified with M0 disjoint union M1, and the identification is part of the data. For technical reasons, it's better to have a little color around the boundaries. So let's say, let's write C in for the incoming color. So 0 infinity cross M0 into W. And C out for the outgoing boundary. So two smooth embeddings with the property that the boundary of W is what it should be. Whoops. Union C out. And these should have disjoint image. So the official definition is these three pieces of data, this one, and that one. By the way, I was promised that the notes for this talk should be up on the app. I haven't checked it, but like as of 20 minutes ago or so, they ought to be there. So all of what I say should be in there. So it's this triple, W, C in, C out. A more classical notion is being cobordant. M0 and M1 are cobordant. If they exist, a cobordism. And just to say where this whole theory came from, in case you hadn't heard it, this is a famous paper of René Thom. defined the notation of his paper, curly N, subscript D, the set of cobordism classes of closed D manifolds. Maybe my indexing I should I'd like D to be the dimension of the cobordism, so maybe I should say like this. Then if you take the direct sum of all of those, you get a graded ring. Addition comes from disjoint union. Product comes from a Cartesian product of smooth manifolds. And also 2 is equal to 0. The unit in this ring is the class of a point. And if you take the disjoint union of that with itself, it's cobordant to the empty set. The empty set is an allowed manifold. And an interval is a cobordism from 2 to 0. And Thom's famous theorem is that this ring is isomorphic to a polynomial ring over the field with 2 elements in 1 generator in each degree, except those that are of the form 2 to the k minus 1. So that completely determines this question of classifying manifolds up to cobordism. Okay, so that's where the whole thing came from. But what we'll talk about in these lectures is not so much whether things are cobordant, but if you have some cobordant things, in how many ways are they cobordant? So call that cob D M0 M1. Well, okay, you can't say the set of cobordisms because that's not a set. But you can say the set of diffeomorphism classes of cobordisms. From M0 to M1. This is going to be empty if that is not cobordant, but otherwise there are presumably more than one way to be cobordant. For example, in this dimension 2 picture, this would be a different reason. Then take this up to diffeomorphism of cobordisms. Which means diffeomorphism preserving, okay, so let me say what that means. So if I have W, C in, C out, and W prime, C in, C out, then I want to declare them diffeomorphic as cobordisms, if they exist a diffeomorphism, W to W prime. That preserves these colors, at least kind of if you restrict up to like epsilon. Such that phi of the color, say the incoming, at t comma x is cn prime of t comma x for all t comma x in, say, 0 epsilon cross M0, some epsilon, and the same condition at the outgoing. Okay. Of course, at some point you might then go on and keep track of the reasons that diffeomorphic cobordisms are diffeomorphic, but right now we'll just take the set of diffeomorphism classes of cobordisms. It's important that we don't say diffeomorphism classes of objects, but on the cobordisms themselves, we say diffeomorphism classes. This set has some structure. Namely, you can compose cobordisms composition of which is incidentally the proof also that being cobordant is an equivalence relation. So again, as the usual. If I have a cobordism from here to there, And another one that starts where this one ends. Then I glue them together. So cobordism from there to there. So in the notes, I write this as, it's often written something like this. So if W is a cobordism from M0 to M1, and W prime from M1 to M2. So I'll probably start omitting these incoming and outgoing parametrizations from the notation, but it's part of the data. So whenever, so I might write just W for this triple, W, C in, C out. But, I mean, sloppy notation. So this means take the disjoint union, and then identify the outgoing boundary of this with the incoming boundary of that. So that's what this gluing means. So that's what you do is.
To identify the colors, actually.
So I do this on the set level.
Just doing it at C is zero. Do you actually want a little color?
So this is what I do for the underlying topological space. And then you have to explain what the smooth structure is. And you use the colors for that to say what you do at the gluing point. There are many ways to say something diffeomorphic to what I say, but what I said in the notes is you do this on the underlying topological space. And if you want a chart around a point that's glued, you take a chart in M1, and then you glue the color in this direction to the color in this direction. So if this is parameterized by U that sits inside RD minus 1, then you get something parameterized by R cross U. And that's what you do on the glued points. And outside the glued points, you just take a chart on either W or W prime. That kind of sits canonically inside this. That gives you smooth manifold with boundary. Then you forget what you the chart you had in the middle, and then use C in and C out prime. And then you check that's a cobordism from M0 to M2. Call this W double prime, comma C in, comma C out prime. The cobordism from M0 to M2. So that's how to prove that being cobordant is an equivalence relation. But it's also, it's kind of obvious that if I replace W by something that's diffeomorphic as a cobordism, then the glued manifolds are again diffeomorphic as cobordisms. So there's a well-defined composition map. Cobordism M0, M1, cross Cob D, M1, M2, to Cob D, M0, M2. Okay. It's of course important that I say diffeomorphic as cobordant, as cobordisms here. Otherwise, this would not be well defined. This is a well defined map of sets. It's also associative. So this is about composing three cobordisms. If you have W, W prime, and W double prime, then the class of W glued along M1 to W prime glued along M2, W double prime. This cobordism is diffeomorphic as cobordisms to if you do it in the other order. This, especially if you're in the back. Okay, associativity. You know what that means. Okay, let me write it. So to check this, you have to check these gluings are diffeomorphic real endpoints. They most likely are not equal cobordisms, because the underlying sets are not equal, but they are diffeomorphic in a canonical way. That's associativity. The last thing is you have identities for this composition. Namely, the diffeomorphism class of, say, an interval is a cobordism that acts as an identity. If you have any cobordism and you glue an interval cross either incoming or outgoing boundary, you get something that's diffeomorphic to what you started with. So that's the axioms for being a category. So that's the cobordism category, the d-dimensional on-oriented cobordism category. Denoted cob D. You should also say smooth. You can imagine other variants with topological manifolds and whatnot. Okay, a tiny comment, something I won't dwell on. If you know what a small category is, it means there should be a set of objects and a set of morphisms. If I really take all, so the objects here will be all smooth closed D minus one manifolds. It's probably better to say that the underlying set should be a subset of some big set, so that you have a set of objects. But up to equivalence of categories, that does not matter. okay, that's the cobordism category. There are lots of fancy versions of this, where you have to talk about higher category theory and whatnot. I might briefly touch on that at some point, but not really. I think most of my lectures will be just be ordinary categories with nothing fancy. And this is the kind of most down-to-earth version of cobordism category. The topic of these lectures is, what can you say about a category, a small category, like the cobordism category, from the classifying space of the category. So classifying space of a small category. See, so small, as I said, means a set of objects. You can't, right. Okay, probably you heard that before. Like the category of sets is not small because there's no set of all sets, but. so you have a small category. There's a topological space that I write BC. That's usually defined in two steps. First, you take the nerve of C, and then you take the geometric realization of that. Where the nerve of C is a simplicial set, so the P simplices. NP of C. It's the set of P tuples of composable morphisms. So the target of F1 should be the source of F2 and so on. Let me abbreviate that to F1 composed with up to FP exists. N0 just means the objects, N1 means the set of all morphisms in C, so on. And geometric realization means disjoint union NP of C cross a standard P simplex, modulo some equivalence relation. okay, it's. You start with a point for each object. Then you glue on an interval, like a one simplex for each morphism. Attach it to the start and end points. Whenever you have a triangle, F, G, and H, you fill it out if H is equal to the composition of F and G. Fill out if H is equal to G composed with F. Etc. So G comma F in that case is going to be an element in N2 of C. And that gives a two simplex. and then you keep going, filling out higher and higher simplices. So that gives a topological space associated to the category. Eventually, I, of course, want to take B of the cobordism category, but let me first discuss in the abstract how much of a category can you recover if you know the classifying space. And I want something like how much of a category up to equivalence of categories can you recover from knowing the classifying space up to homotopy equivalence, something of that flavor.
So is BC a topological space or a homotopy type?
It's a topological space, yeah. Likewise, C is not an equivalence class of categories. So this is how to turn a category into a space. In the other direction, I can turn a space into a category, namely the fundamental groupoid that I'm going to denote pi 1 of x. It's a category. It's actually a groupoid. The objects are just the points of x, and the morphisms from one point to another are the homotopy classes of paths, starting here and ending there. So, hom pi 1 x, x comma y, is paths up to homotopy, real endpoint. Composition is concatenation of paths, which is associative up to homotopy real endpoints. And all paths are invertible up to homotopy real endpoints. The automorphism group of a point is just the usual fundamental group based at that point, but this kind of encodes. It encodes both all the fundamental groups and pi 0 x into one object. I want to consider this as some sort of partial inverse to the other process, or that kind of point of view that will be helpful in these lectures. More precisely, if I start with a small category, turn it into a space, and then take fundamental groupoid of that space, then there's a canonical functor from where I started to where I ended. So by definition of BC, it contains, as a subspace, the set of objects. So objects of C, by definition, is the zero simplices of BC that sits inside as a discrete subspace. So that's what this functor does on objects. Send an object there to the corresponding point in BC, regarded as an object in the fundamental groupoid. On morphisms, so if I have F in C x comma y, by the way, I'm using this notation to mean the hom set in C from x to y. The way BC is constructed, the one simplices are precisely the morphisms. So for each morphism, there's a canonical path from x to y by definition. So I send this to the corresponding one simplex. So I guess it would be So this sits inside N1 of C. So strictly speaking, the notation would be something like F cross delta 1. And then you parameterize this as the interval. And this canonically maps to BC. A path starting at X and ending at Y. So that's what this canonical functor does on morphisms. Then to check that it's a functor, I have to check that it preserves composition. But that's what the two simplices do. If I compose these, I get that one. This concatenation is homotopic to that one. So the two simplices is what makes gamma a functor. Preserving composition. Okay. Now, it's likely not an equivalence of categories. For example, this thing is always a groupoid. So if this thing is not a groupoid, then it can't be an equivalence. For example, if you have like the most trivial example of a non-groupoid category, two objects and one morphism between them, one non-identity morphism, then BC is homeomorphic to just an interval. So the fundamental groupoid is going to be trivial, whereas this is not a trivial category. But that's in some sense the only problem. Not prove it, but it's kind of a standard proof. If C is a groupoid, then gamma is an equivalence of categories. So no information is lost in that case. By going from C to BC, you can get C back up to equivalence by taking fundamental groupoid. I'm sure many of you have seen that, especially in the case if the category has only one object, then being a groupoid is the same as being a group. Then BC is the usual construction of Eilenberg-MacLane spaces, k pi 1. And this just becomes a statement that you can get the group back by taking pi 1 of